Welcome, everyone.
Good morning.
How's everybody? Good. It's a great day. Beautiful day. So beautiful. I was amazed and overwhelmed. Again, every Sunday when I come to the Bible study, I learn so much. And I get to know where Sonoma is. Really, because the world I live on the other side of the hill, it's a lot different. Not only the climate, the attitude, the culture. And I am just thrilled to be with you because thanks so much, because I learned so much. And who is this handsome couple in front? Hi. Yeah, you got. Sorry, I got to warn you. You can't be darker than me, okay? Because I get jealous. So you be careful. Beautiful, beautiful tan. Well, welcome to our dialogue. Welcome to listening to where God is, and God, where God is directing us. And welcome to a church of fun. I'm having fun, and I hope you're having fun. Let's enjoy the day.
If we could all stand and join for the call to worship as Wyota makes her way forward.
Thank you so much.
Christ is the image of the invisible God, as Christ is the firstborn of all creation.
Earth and all that is in it were created by God. Whether high or low, rich or poor, strong or weak, boisterous or meek,
God created Christ before all things to hold all things together.
Christ is the head of the body, the church, the beginning of all that it is, so that he might have first place in everything, including our hearts and minds.
For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile all things to make himself, by making peace through the symbol of the cross. Though we all are at one time or another estranged and hostile in mind,
we have been forgiven and made new. We are presented as holy and blameless and irreproachable in God's sight.
While we remain grounded and steadfast in our faith, we can become both servant and leader in the commission that was given to us by God, to make the word of God fully known to all, so all may receive the hope of the glory of God found in Jesus Christ.
Let us together proclaim the love of God, our Creator, teaching the perfect wisdom, so that we may all be presented as honest, sure in faith, and mature in Christ.
Please remain standing and sing our opening hymn with us, number 2270, He Has Made Me Glad.
Made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made
If you can, unless you don't want to.
So if you would indulge me a little bit this morning, I would like for us to approach our prayer time together a little differently. And not because we need to, but sometimes doing things differently helps to bring the focus back to us. So what I would like for you to do is to turn to your neighbor and offer them something that was joyful for you this week. Even if it's just that you got up this morning. I got up this morning. I'm excited about that.
I'm glad you're excited.
I hope that you folks on the Zoom can hear all the chatter of all the joy that's happening in this room right now. This is very exciting. Thank you all for that. And that actually brings more smile to my face and my heart than hearing all the individual things, that interaction and camaraderie. So for all of these joys, I would like for us to lift up in great praise,
thanks be to God.
So we do have a song of joy that we are going to sing, though. I don't remember what it is, but it's number 63 in your hymnal. So let's sing
Blessed
that. Blessed be the name. Let's sing that a couple of times.
Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name.
We come to that time that we get to share those things that lay heavy on our hearts. And so that we can think about this a little bit differently, I'd like for you to take a moment and open yourselves up to receiving the grace of God in this time. Lay your hands open on your lap, your chest and body open so that you can truly be in a relaxed, relieving state. And think on those who need God's healing touch, healing of body, healing of heart, healing of spirit, healing of thought, healing from fear and pain and anguish. Those who are in our midst and those who are not with us in presence today. And Lord, we lift these up and say, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Every week we come together and we have a long list of those individuals who need God's presence in their lives for whatever reason. So I ask you to think on them now. And let God's Holy Spirit work through you to reach them. And we gather our voices together and say, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We have many among us who have friends and family who are traveling, who are visiting loved ones, which is a joyous occasion, but the travel makes us concerned. We have many among us whose lives are in a bit of disarray because of moving or family challenges or family illnesses, things that bring discomfort to our souls. So we allow our words and our thoughts now to be lifted up in their name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we have all of those things that are left unspoken every single week, part of every day, that we lay heavy on us, but we now get together as one body of believers to relieve that pressure from ourselves, knowing that being here together, the Holy Spirit will lift that burden from us as we pray together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And I would ask, as you sing our centering song today, there are cards in the back. If you have a prayer that you would like lifted up individually, please make sure to fill that out and leave it in the offering plate at some time today so we can get you added to the prayer chain. These are important things for this community of believers to pray together, and important things for you to know that God is always listening and God will never leave us alone. If you would join in our centering song, Sweet Hour of Prayer, number 496, verse 3, please.
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet.
Share the glory, hear the glory, and be sustained, O God, by your watching over us. We have gone through the expressions of our joy silently. We have shared our concerns silently. Now we lift them up unto you, O God, to embrace them, to take them, still listening to us, embracing us because of your love and mercy upon us. Hear, O God, our prayers and supplications. Hear, O God, and embrace one another. Hear, O God, the voice, the concerns, the pleas of this city, this state, and this nation. And of course, the troubled world. The troubled world still in Ukraine. Oh God, bless these thy people from Sonoma United Methodist Church who are aware of the pains and struggles, and at the same time understand because they themselves know what joy is, that they are celebrating your presence, celebrating your guidance as they see their grandchildren grow and celebrate the life that's given unto them. celebrating the nuances of many things that surround us, seen and unseen. And I know that, the people here in Sonoma are blessed and grateful and thankful. This is the ones, the prayers that sustain us, that help us build the foundation through our faithfulness. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God for the courage, the stamina. And thank you for the courage, O God, of those who are not feeling well, and yet they come to you, and they come to us with expression of thanksgiving. Those, O God, are the signs of their faithfulness. And we are touched by them and sustained by them. Bless these thy people who hunger after your thirst in glory and in supplications. These, O God, we ask together as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and a power, and a glory forever. Amen. Excuse me.
This is from Luke 10, 38 through 42. At the home of Martha and Mary, as Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her."
If we could all join together in number 2176, "Make Me a Servant," as we prepare to hear the words of God.
Make me
Does that mean I can use that now? I can play the your piano now? Oh, okay. I don't know how well I will do this today because my voice is so raspy. But this is a song that I composed for a couple, Marion and Lloyd Walkie. Have you heard of them? Yeah, you have, yeah. Lloyd was my mentor when I was in Glide. And I was asked to compose a song for him for his 35th anniversary in the ministry. Lloyd passed about 5-6 years ago. And this is, I call this, the title is Our Pledge. I hope my microphone is on. Our hope is in our God, the God who made us one, that one day we'll see that promise fulfilled. By faith of different shades. Oh God, let us dare to a breakthrough, to achieve. With you by our side, we can still peace perceive. Bless our imperfect ways. We've stumbled through our weak, selfish drive to catch your eyes. Now humbled by your gracious surprise, you heal our lives. Hear now our pledge to you. One household to serve your call within. Injustice to fight, your cause to win. Help us to hold the host of sin. We stumble through our weak, selfish drives to catch your eyes. Now humbled by your gracious surprise, you heal our lives. Hear now our pledge to you. One household to serve your call within. Injustice to fight your cause to win. Help us to hold the host of sin. You can tell that Lloyd and Marion were people who believe in all of God's children, all colors, understands the transitions that's taking place in the world, and we just love them, and he's given me so much blessing that I have no other choice but to give back to that beautiful man. You know, some years ago, the Archbishop of Canterbury was rushing to catch the train in London. And in his haste, he accidentally jumped on a wrong passenger car and found himself on a car full of inmates from a mental hospital. They were all dressed up in mental hospital clothing just as the train pulled out of the station. And an orderly came in and began to count the inmates. One, two, three, four. And when suddenly he saw this distinguished looking guy wearing a business suit and a clerical collar, and he said, "Who are you?" The answer came back, "I am the Archbishop of Canterbury." And the orderly said, "Five, six, seven, eight. Thank you, Dave. I'm glad I paid you for that laughter today. I knew many wouldn't understand it, but thank you." The point of the story is this: it is so important to know who we are and who other people are. One of the blessings I got last week is to having a visit from Richard Servison. And I tell you, I am blessed because of that particular time. If we know what makes us tick, and I think I'm getting to know Richard very well now, and what makes other people tick, we get along better. If we understand where we are coming from and where other people are coming from, we relate better. There is more compassion, more empathy, and more kindness. That's why in recent years, we have heard so much, excuse me, about the personality traits. Aaron isn't here to confirm that. But you know, HR nowadays, when they hire new employees, they give them a personality test to see how they would fit in. So therefore, employers, counselors, and job placement agencies are using them effectively. You may have heard of the Berkman personality profile, anyone? Oh my goodness, this guy from Rotary knows everything. Let me tell you, can't get away from you. I want to use it this morning as a way to study our passage of the scripture. So let's start this morning as we look at this somewhat confusing story of Mary and Martha that we read this morning in Luke 10. Dr. Roger Bergman, who is a psychologist from Houston, has developed a fascinating computer personality profile, which suggests, broadly speaking, that there are four different kinds of personality traits or style, as some of you may use. Let me outline them for us to see. See if you can find yourself or someone you know somewhere between the lines. The first one is what? Scott? Okay. Oh, you didn't take it. They must have known you too well. The first one is, there is the action-oriented doer. The person is action-oriented and strong-willed. The autocratic doer means business and everybody else better get out of the way. I think they must have been you, Scott, so they didn't want to give that to you. The second one is the detailed planner. The person plans the work and then works on a plan. The detailed planner's personality is precisely what the name implies, one who thinks through in a great deal detail, one who plans ahead, one who wants things done neatly, orderly, and systematically. The detailed planner does really well as long as no one messes up the plan. Now, that must have been Sue because she smiled or giggled. I didn't, you did it, I didn't. The third personality style, according to Dr. Bergman, is the enthusiastic salesperson. This person has no plan. The enthusiastic salesperson is a people person who operates on personality and has a strong ability to wow people and win them over and sell them on his or her ideas of a dream. Or dreams. The fourth personality, enthusiastic salesperson, anyone? Oh my goodness, thank you for a lot. All right. A fourth personality suggested by Berkman's profile is the artistic, poetic philosopher. This person is more soulful, more turned into beauty, reverence, and awe. The artistic, poetic philosopher is creative, one who enjoys quiet and pensive moments of solitude, one who can turn in to the wonders of the universe, one who can experience a sunset or Brahms melody and feel in that experience the presence of God nearer than breathing. Raise your hand. I know my wife is. And I figure you would be one. Anybody else? Okay, there you go. The point of Roger Bergman's computer personality profile is we are different when we recognize, understand, respect, and celebrate our differences, we get along better. This idea was rooted in the Bible. It is one of the key themes of St. Paul's letter to the church of Corinth. Some are prophets and some are teachers. Some are action-oriented while others are pensive and thoughtful. Some are poetic and some are autocratic. Some are loud and some are quiet. We are different people with different personalities, different styles, different temperaments, and that's okay. Indeed, it is necessary as long as we are loving and tolerant about it. Now, tell me, where does Mary fit in those four categories? The planner? No? I can't hear you.
Oh, the thoughtful.
Thoughtful one? Okay.
Or the doer.
What's that?
The doer.
The doer? Martha was a doer.
Mary did what she wanted to do. Martha does what she thinks
Uh-huh. Okay. What about Martha? She's the planner. Uh-huh. Okay. All right. Now, Richard, where is your wife in that? Oh, I know about you, but I don't know her as well. I don't know whether I don't know what that fit is. He must be a doer then. Huh? She said, I do.
Keep working at it, Dick.
This is not a right or wrong answer. You know, I don't want you to think you're getting in trouble. Yeah. Okay. Those are very pleasant. Yeah. What did you say? A giver. Uh-huh. Okay. All right. Anyone? And you? Tell me who you are and what do you fit in that category? The artist. Okay. The one who is really loves the environment and sitting still and watching the fish.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love doing that.
Uh-huh, yeah. There you go. There you go. Yes, ma'am. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You can fit in those lines. Yeah. It's not perfect. Berkman said that, you know, it's not, you know, black. Yeah. But yeah. You could have a little bit of those. But all of us stand out with particular personality. Yeah, well, that's what the Bible said. I don't know if I believe it. You're right. Yeah. The beauty of the Bible study, when we're with the Bible study, is that they're not so, you know, rigid. That they look at other possibilities. Okay. Go ahead, Carol. Say more. Yeah.
But you just reaffirmed what I said last week about the recipe of life. Every recipe has a different degree. Some are strong, some are mild, some, you know, and so we're all part of that recipe.
Mm-hmm. Viva the little difference. Mm-hmm. Wasn't there a book that was written not too long ago? Men are from Mars and women are from Venus. Yeah, is that say the same thing? Pretty much. Yeah. Something triggered something that should we know about that? Wow. Yeah. Well. Yeah. Oh, you're right. Yeah. Yes, Sue. Were you going to say something?
No.
But you know, people. Is it true that the more they get to know people, the better you relate with each other? Yes. No. But sometimes they said, the more you know each other, the more you know how to get back at them. But that didn't say anything anywhere. Yeah.
See, I was going to say, the reason I said I thought Mary was the doer is that Mary, if you accept the Bible's end statement that she had the right course, she saw what needed to be done, and she did it, and she didn't care what Martha or anybody else thought about it. She just went and did it. Mm-hmm. Sit at Jesus' feet and listen to it, because that's what needed to be done.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Martha, I think, is almost a combination of the salesman. She's trying to convince Jesus that she's right and Martha's wrong. And also the probably also the planner too.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Good point. Good point. Yes, Carol.
I think it's also that Jesus wants Martha to know it's another way of looking at things. Expand the horizons at that particular moment. That's what was most important.
Okay. I see you nodding your head. You were saying something, Bev? Are you sure? I thought you were ready too. Okay. All right. Any more points, Carol? Because I love the way how you think. Okay. Dan, what do you think? Okay, that's okay. Yeah. Yes, David. Mary and Martha. Carol, where do you think you fit in? You Martha or Mary? You. Yeah, I agree. Yes, Dan.
I woke up.
Okay. I'm glad you're with us. That's deep. Yeah. Charlene?
I'm not a Bible scholar, but I think Mary accepted her role in earth these times. Martha is an open person.
Okay. Thank you. How about the race? Any comment? Definitely a Martha. You know, for your confession, let me state my confession. I am a Martha. Yeah, I am. My wife is definitely a Mary. Yeah. Anyone else?
Did it take every one of us to make the recipe? So don't we have to have a little of everything?
Yeah, but what I'm saying is there's a little, you have a little edge more of the particular categories. I'm not saying you're not part of this or that, but you're more identified because of that personality that we have, the DNA that we have. Yeah.
I think what Viola is saying is that
we Yeah. And one of the things that I really appreciate knowing that the last three, four weeks we're here is that you guys recognize your role and you give and share from yourself with integrity and honesty. You don't play around and, you know, play games. And I really appreciate that. And I see a lot of that happening, especially in a city in politics like that. But you guys are really real people. And I rejoice that. And what do you think of my observation, John, about the people here? You feel, am I, same, Joanna, yeah. Where did you guys go?
Caribbean, I don't know, St. Martin.
Uh-huh, yeah, we've been there. Beautiful, yeah. And I think, what is your name, ma'am?
Kathy.
You know, why did they say Mary is right? I had a suspicion that Christ was concerned about certain consequences. Now, from a theological perception, and you have freedom to interpret that, you know, and I keep thinking that it may have something to do with the fact that Martha's personality has to do with resentment. And Christ was concerned about that she's doing that to herself. Martha was resenting Mary. And in my opinion, there is nothing more destructive to our spiritual lives than resentment. Now, you don't have to agree with me, but I pick that up as you pray and study, and it can absolutely ruin your life, and Jesus knew it. It concerned him to see this dangerous attitude of resentment in Martha. And I get into this Greek stuff, but I'm not going to get into that. So beware of resentment. It is dangerous. Beware of brooding, seething anger. Beware of resentful gossip. Beware of the contemptuous resentment tone or attitude. All of these are murderous. They are all devastating. We see it here in Mary and Martha's story in a couple of dramatic ways. First, notice the word used to describe Martha. Three words: distracted, anxious, troubled. That's what resentment does to you. Secondly, there is the dangerous attitude of narrowness. Thank you, Jean. Yeah, Martha is done in by her narrow perspective. Martha thinks her way is the only way, and she wants to force her way on Mary. I get in trouble with that myself, you know, because I think Kara's laughing, smiling. Yeah, Martha's view has become so narrow that she can't see any other way to receive the master. But her way, she is blind to the miracle uniqueness. And that's why I like these guys here who, you know, see the world in a green, open world. And that's why Carol is such a beautiful human being, that she allows me to see things that I do not see, because I could be rigid at times. And Carol says, most of the time, no. How often I have seen this narrow attitude cause problems theologically, and we see that, and you guys talk about that in a Bible study, how narrow people feel about, they don't recognize that the world is a global religious world, not just one religion. They don't understand that God is big enough to relate to each one of us differently. And that's where you come in beautifully. I should state that so differently, individually, uniquely, and personally. The third one is, finally, there is unkindness. Don't miss this now. When will we ever learn? Martha tried to make herself look good by making Mary look bad, and it boomeranged on her, and it came out in this instance, the unattractive one. Ultimately, it happens every time. Our harsh, condemning judgment come back to haunt us. When we are unkind to others, we are the ones who end up looking bad. The point is clear, I think. What we send out, what we send out comes back. If we send our kind, when we send out unkindness, it comes back to us and haunts us. If we send our grace and love and compassion, those come back to bless us. In Mary and Martha's story, Jesus is teaching us a great lesson about our inner attitudes. And he is saying, beware of resentment, beware of narrowness, and beware of unkindness. Choose instead the way of grace and love and the compassion. May we pray. Dear God, we hope we learn something about ourselves today and learn about others. And we hope, oh God, that we are not so judgmental in such a way that we close doors rather than open those doors. Allow us, dear God, to be open to possibilities, because America is changing, going through a transition. And America is the greatest nation in the world. We believe that. I believe that. So therefore, those of us who are privileged enough to know the difference of resentment and narrowness and finally unkindness, that we would stand tall and express greater love and mercy than what is happening now in our community, in our nation, and the world. Lift us up, O God. I know these people are beginning to understand that they have big responsibility and role, because they are closer to you than many. We ask this blessing upon all of us in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise you, our God, for the giving of this beautiful gifts. that come from our hearts and his deep supplication. Amen.
Trained. Do we have any announcements that are not already on the back of your bulletin with all of our regularly scheduled activities? I have a few, but I want to make sure everything is appointed appropriately. I know that the men's group is meeting the first Friday of August. That's a week away, and it will be at the Goodwins, at the Goodwins home. So if you have any questions about that, will it be on Zoom as well?
Yes.
So if you have any questions, Charles will be happy to answer any questions about that. If you've not been part of the men's group, that might be something that you might want to consider if you're a man. I might show up one day just for fun. Are there any other announcements or any announcements from our virtual sanctuary this morning? None? Okay. So I do have a few. Pastor Tony and Carol will be traveling for the next few weeks, so I will be available. I will be in the office area someplace Tuesday through Thursday from 12:15 to 1:45. If you need help any other time, my phone number, cell phone number, email are in the directory. If you need anything, you can always call the church office because Maggie can reach me pretty much anywhere, anytime. Leading worship during Reverend Tony's absence will be myself on the 24th, Candy Weeder, which will be a nice treat, on July 31st, and Maggie Huffman on August 7th, leading us in communion as well. I do want to make a couple of really important, those were nice announcements. These are very, very important. Most of you probably have received or will shortly be receiving a letter regarding the State of the Union, so to speak, with a survey enclosed. I made some assumptions when I sent that out, when I prepared that. It's actually from the Church Council, and I put on there that it was from the Spiritual Action Committee. But we're gathering the information so that we can hopefully begin to foster real change in our community and in our community's lives. So please, when you get your survey, go ahead and fill it out. You can send it to the church office in the envelope enclosed. They're anonymous. Please don't put your name on it. We really don't want to know who you are, but we do want to know what is going on in your life. The last piece of information is that there is in your bulletin a volunteer signup form. We're trying to make it easy on you to volunteer for things. So if there's anything of interest, if it's a short-term one-time only, or if it's something that you'd like to serve with us in a longer term, please make sure to fill that out and put your contact information on it so that we know who filled that out. It's nice to know that, you know, somebody said they want to ring the bell on Sunday, but we kind of need to know who that is and which Sunday that is. But there are some great things that you can do on a very short-term basis that require very little training and skill, and other things if you have some skill in that area or want to learn more. There are a lot of opportunities to serve your church, and we want everybody to be as welcome and offering of their gifts as possible. We want you to all be included in the actual function of worship here. You know what? I don't know if coffee got made this morning. I didn't make coffee. I was doing other things, so I apologize. So we will have some social time without coffee after worship today. If there are no other announcements, I would ask that you please stand and join with us in singing our closing hymn this morning, Sent Forth by God's Blessings, number 664, I think.
Of our
our faith ever sharing, in love ever caring, embracing God's children of each tribe and race. Thank you be to God that we are allowed, aware, and mindful, O God, of the world we live in. Continue, O God, the blessings of this church to reach out and to make the world part of thy kingdom on this earth. Let us rejoice for all that we have experienced today, the music, the word of God, and the opportunity to be in that deep relationship. Bless us, enrich us, and keep us safe in your care. In the name of the Father, the Son, and thy Holy Spirit, to whom we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.